Everybody, Lisa Irmano here, the Breakthrough Life Coach, and today I'm doing a video about Kate Spade and Anthony Bourdain and their recent suicides. And this is a subject matter that is dear and near to my heart as somebody who wanted to commit suicide at the age of 12, who saw it as the only way out, who was in so much pain, and just believed I was a burden. There was something wrong with me. People were better off without me. I couldn't do anything right. And very interesting, the way my brain began to justify and validate my thinking at the time, which I think I had a right to feel. My life was very dark at the time, and it was very tough for a 12-year-old kid. And so I didn't understand at the time that my brain was designed to escape pain and to seek pleasure. I didn't know that at the time, but I didn't know that once you make a decision to do something, your brain has to come up with a bunch of excuses and rationalizations to actually do it. Think about people who rob banks. The minute they make a decision to rob a bank, they've got 10 reasons to justify why they robbed a bank. Think about a man who punches a woman in the face. You know, the minute he makes that decision, before he cocks his fist and punches her in the face, he's got 10 reasons in his head why he should do that. It's the way the brain works. But we don't understand that. We don't gain enough perspective around the way our mind thinks to be able to observe and witness what's happening, you know, on the emotional plane or even on the conscious plane, because we don't have enough higher consciousness about what's happening in our bodies. At least I don't think so. I know that when I was in the most pain in my life, I didn't know that that pain didn't have to take me down. I didn't know that I could witness that pain. I didn't know that I could separate myself, my true self, from the pain. I didn't know that I could look at pain like you look at a pair of socks. You know, you put socks on and you take socks off. The socks are not you. You know, they might be on you. They might be a part of you for a time, but that it is not you, right? So pain in my, now I look at pain as an indicator. It lets me know where I am. So if I'm angry, that means something's going on in my experience that I need to look at. Something happened to me. If I'm sad, something happened to me. Could have happened 20 years ago, right? But I could be feeling it now, or something could be happening now. And I'm being triggered. And my body is reacting viscerally to what's been stored in the past. There are so many reasons for why we feel pain. And the more we understand pain and the more we learn to look at pain from a higher perspective, I think the greater our chances of reducing suicide, you know, across the globe. I wanted to do this video for a couple of reasons. A, to talk a little bit about pain, you know, B, to really inspire anybody out there who feels like, you know, life just ain't worth living. I wanted to encourage you to understand that your brain is designed to seek escape. I personally believe that our brain is not designed for healing. It's not. It's designed to run away from forest fires. Healing requires us to stop, to look, and to listen to our pain. And when I think about somebody like Kate Spade, for instance, who had this huge, huge business, and I think about all her responsibilities, you know, I think about all the people that she may have been afraid to disappoint because she had a, you know, a happy-go-lucky brand. I think about how hard it must have been for her to tell her truth, to stop the wheels of this mega, mega business that she created, and then to disappoint the people that worked for her brand, right? I think about how difficult it must be to be somebody who's got paparazzi up your ass, how difficult it is to like just go out, you know, for a cup of coffee, you know, and chat with a bunch of girlfriends about how sad you are, how depressed you are, you know? I mean, you've got people following you everywhere, talking about you, right? When you're a celebrity, you're actually being pushed by publicists and agents and managers or whatever to personify, you know, the life. You know, that's part of your brand. Act like you got your shit together. Act like everything's awesome. And I think about the stress that that puts on somebody, you know. And then what happens is, you know, here we are as consumers, you know, so obsessed with celebrities of all different shapes, sizes, and football players, basketball players, pop stars, you name it. And we really do think, wow, they have something that I don't. And on some level, I think that we have to catch ourselves if we think that they're different than us, because they're not. They have the same emotions. They have amygdalas, and they have a hippocampus, and they have childhood programming, and they have parents, and they have siblings, and they've got narcissistic bullshit to contend with, and codependency, and fears, and all of that. They have people pushing them, you know, to make money, because if they make money, everybody else makes money. But the reality is the celebrity is really, you know, the person at the top of the food chain who is making it possible for all these underlings to make money. You know, and so I don't think it's very easy for a celebrity to say, I have a drug problem, or I have depression, or I'm drinking too much. You know, I just think about the enormous pressure that happens to somebody in that role. And so I think that we need to be a little bit more responsible as a society, and we need to stop putting people before ourselves in any capacity. We have to understand that pain, you know, it's very interesting. You know, so many people commit suicide because they feel like they're letting people down, or they can't face letting people down, right? And then if you notice, the world never stops spinning for anybody. You know, when Elvis Presley died, the world didn't stop spinning. You know, when think about all the people that you admired and looked up to, you know, and have passed on, the world doesn't stop spinning for you, right? So you shouldn't, your world shouldn't stop spinning for anybody else. So if you're in pain, you know, really look at that. Like, the world does not stop spinning for anybody. So why should your world stop spinning for somebody or for something? I think that what we have to learn to do in our society and in our lives and in our homes and in our relationships and within the space between our ears from left to right, right to left, we have to learn to start telling our truth. So our psychic, you know, conscious self has to be able to say to our hearts, I see you, I feel you. We've got to be able to acknowledge with our throat chakra what's happening in our heart space, what's happening in our root chakra. We've got to learn to say, this is how I feel. So if I'm unhappy, I'm unhappy. It sucks, but I'm unhappy. I don't want to be married anymore. I don't want to be married anymore. And I know that sucks, but that's the way I feel. Or, you know, I'm tired of getting kicked around, you know, or I'm sad. You know, I don't know why I'm sad. I'm just sad. You know, I just had a baby, you know, and I think I should be really, really happy that I just had a baby. But for some reason, I'm not so happy, you know. We've got to get past this idea that what we feel, we shouldn't feel. You know, what I do with my personal clients, what I do in my coaching programs, is I teach people to acknowledge how they feel. And that could be really, really scary because the brain is designed to run away from pain, right? It's no coincidence that addiction is such a huge problem, you know. The problem is that we don't understand the human psyche and we don't understand ourselves emotionally, right? And so we have all these stigmas from society. You can't watch a show, right, on television or on cable without being, you know, having to watch a commercial about depression and about medication. And you know, the message is there's something wrong with you if you're depressed. So take this medication so you could be happy. You know, there might be issues where people have where their brain chemistry is off, and certain medications could stabilize brain chemistry. But I don't think it's wise to mess with someone's brain unless you know what part of their brain is inactive or is not as stimulated as it should be. So I think we need brain scans before we start medicating ourselves and trying to, you know, stimulate certain parts of the brain. That's just my shtick. And there are psychiatrists that are actually doing that. And I do suggest that if you think that you have an imbalance, that you look psychiatrists up that are actually scanning your brain before they medicate you. I think it's a really smart idea. But that being said, I think that we have to heal our culture. And, you know, anything that happens in a society usually starts with an idea, you know, and lots of times it's a grassroots effort. And lots of times it's one person or a bunch of people who start talking about different ideas. And slowly this new way of thinking begins to filter into, hearts and minds and families and then congregations and organizations or whatever. But I think that we have to begin with us. We have to change. We have to learn to understand how our brain works. You are designed, your brain is designed to run away from pain. So if you've got pain, you have to understand that your brain is going to do everything it can to avoid coming into conscious contact with that. That could be working. That could be sex. That could be drinking. That could be anger. That could be frustration. That could be blaming people and playing the victim and keeping the focus on everybody else but yourself. You know, that could be self-righteousness. You know, that could be gambling. So we are designed to not feel what's going on inside of us. At least I think so, right? That's what denial is about, suppression is about. That's what ego defense mechanism is about. To heal, you've got to make a conscious decision to look within. And that's not easy, like I said, because we're designed to run away from forest fires. You couple this idea that as human beings, their brains and their bodies are designed to avoid pain, right? Think about emotional pain. Now you couple that with this idea that the outer world, society, and the messages that you're getting are, you're crazy if you're depressed. There's something wrong with you if you're depressed. You have a mental illness if you're depressed, right? I personally think that if you are somebody who's has a difficult marriage and you're running a major corporation and people are leaning on you and you're tired and you're exhausted, you know, and you're unfulfilled and you've kind of perhaps created an empire that, you know, is now boxed you in a corner. Now you feel like you have to do it. You know, I think it's fair to say it's okay if you're not happy all the time. But what do you do when you're that person and you don't know how to tell your truth, or you're ashamed of your truth, or you don't think that you have a right to be depressed because you know that the world looks at you like you have everything? All of this freaking gets all mumbled up in your head and your heart. Where do you go with that stuff, right? And so your brain is designed to avoid pain. You start drinking because you know what? It doesn't hurt so much when you drink. Makes sense. It just makes sense. But it's dysfunctional and it's toxic and it's not going to end well, right? So I think that what we have to recognize as a society, rather than, because I was just at Trader Joe's recently, and as I'm packing my bags, I'm hearing these two women talk about Kate Spade and Anthony Bourdain, and I hear the woman say, you know, I can't believe how selfish she was, that she killed herself. And I was like, you know, like shaking my head, like what? You know, and here I am bagging, and I said, oh my God, and this is why there is so much shame in a person who looks like and knows she looks like and he looks like they should be sitting on top of the world, but they don't feel that way. And they know that they're going to be judged for not being happy. They know that people are going to like, what are you talking about? You're Kate Spade, man. You're Anthony Bourdain. What are you talking about? You're unhappy, dude. Look at all you've got, right? Totally being invalidated. Nobody's hearing them. Nobody's understanding what they went through. So here I am at Trader Joe's, and I hear these two women, you know, who have the luxury of being able to go to Trader Joe's without anybody following them, who can go home perhaps, and they are running companies that are multi-million dollar, billion dollar companies, and they have a lot of stress in their life. Who knows? Let's, for argument's sake, say they're like the rest of us who are not in that situation, you know, that have the luxury of going home and not feeling super, super responsible. And maybe they're not depressed, right? And maybe they're in happy marriages. Maybe they're just happy people, right? So it's really, really easy to judge somebody when you haven't walked in their shoes. Really, really easy. And so I think the other thing that I want to address is that those of us who are judging people who have committed suicide. You gotta understand, I come from a long line of suicide. My grandmother committed suicide. My brother-in-law committed suicide. My sister's husband. My best friend's father threw himself out of a window. Another best friend's aunt walked out into the water with bricks in her pockets and drowned herself. I mean, I'm surrounded by it. And, you know, I had a friend's son who committed suicide not far from our home. I mean, it's just, horrendous. And so I know this pain, and I also wanted to commit suicide at 12. I understand it. You know, when you haven't walked in someone's shoes, please don't judge. Don't judge people. You know, this is not going to help us heal the world of suicide or suicide ideation. What's going to help heal the world is compassion. What's going to help heal the world is awareness. What's going to help heal the world is us taking responsibility for what we can take responsibility for. So what that means is that we have got to learn to tell our truth. Mothers and fathers have got to get comfortable with talking about how they feel, right? We've got to say to our kids, wow, I'm not feeling very happy today. How am I going to take care of that? Maybe I'll go for a walk. That always makes me feel better, you know? Or maybe I'll go call a best friend. Or you know what? Maybe I'll go find a therapist because I really shouldn't be talking to you kids about how I feel. You know, just know that I'm taking care of it. And you know what? My feelings, they're just letting me know something's going on. They don't have to be me. I am enough. We've got to start teaching our children to speak about how they feel, right? We've got to stop. I have a client who said, when I told my mother that I was going to commit suicide, she said, that's the stupidest thing I've ever heard. You should be ashamed of yourself. Oh my God. Yeah, you would kill yourself. You would do that to me. Oh my God. Making this child's internal reality and pain and hopelessness all about her. No wonder the kid's thinking about committing suicide. You know, really? So somebody who's raised by that type of a human being who doesn't even realize she's made her daughter's hopelessness about her, so this kid is completely invisible, why wouldn't that kid be depressed? Are you kidding me? Of course that child's upset. I guess my point is, there are so many points. We shouldn't judge people, right? There, but for the sake of God, go I. If you're one of the fortunate people, like my husband, who knew his mother loved him, who cannot even wrap his mind around this idea that people like Anthony Bourdain would want to kill himself, you know? Good for you. Get on your hands and your knees and thank the stars that you are one of the lucky few on planet Earth that knows that you're enough and always has. But there are a lot more of us who struggle with thinking that we're enough, and there are a lot more of us that struggle with knowing how to validate how we feel. So many of us think, oh, maybe it's not a big deal. I've had clients, and I struggled this with myself, say, I didn't even know if I should go into therapy because I didn't know if what I was feeling was that big of a deal. Doubting yourself on that level. Are you kidding me? I understand that. I didn't go into therapy for years because I was like, maybe it's not a big deal. Because I was so codependent and I needed other people to validate my internal experiences. But here's the kick in the ass, right? The people in my life, their agenda was to invalidate my internal experience, right? Because they weren't validating their own internal experience. But it took me decades to figure that out, people. And now I want to teach you that. I want to teach you to understand that the truth sets you free. Now, that doesn't mean the truth is doesn't feel like you're walking on nails, because sometimes and oftentimes the truth is hard. I imagine Kate Spade saying to the people on her team, I need a break. I got to go into rehab. You know, I got to take off for 6 months. Could you imagine what that must have felt like for her to admit? She worried so much about her brand, I'm sure. I'm sure she worried about what people thought. I'm sure she worried about what that meant for the people on her team. I'm sure. The enormous responsibility. And who are you going to honor? Are you going to honor the outer world? Are you going to honor the inner world? And I can tell you, dear ones, I can tell you right now that our job is to learn how to set ourselves free. It is our job to honor the self. We must take ultimate responsibility for how we feel. And if our decision affects other people, as long as we are honoring the self and we're coming from love. We're not trying to hurt somebody. We're not trying to destroy somebody. We're not being self-righteous. We're not trying to tear someone apart, you know? We're not pulling out of a business because we want everyone to fall apart. We are only trying to say, I'm in trouble. I need help. I know this is going to affect you, but I got to take care of me. I am telling you that is the way to set yourself free. And then what will happen is the outside will look fucked up. It will, right? And I can tell you from experience that when you feel all jarbled up on the inside, right, and you're doing a hell of a job making sure that outside of you looks perfect, that's what you get. You get mixed soup, or you're all messed up on the inside, but you're doing your best to look like you've got your shit together on the outside. And that's what people see. You box yourself into a corner, because now telling your truth is that much harder, because you know the truth, right? And I did this myself. You are participating in the facade, right? And so now it takes so much courage to say, I want out. I need a break. I'm not so happy. I'm not as happy as everybody wants me to be. And I know this is going to affect everything that I've created, but I have to tell my truth, whatever it is. That takes so much courage. Takes so much courage. And I don't blame anybody for not doing it, because it is the toughest thing in the world to do, is to know that your decisions are going to upset the apple cart. You will be judged. You will be labeled. They're coming for you. The lawyers are coming. You know, the hounds are coming. The people who relied on you to make their life happy and cozy, they turn on you. That's what happens. And so, dear ones, learning to tell your truth helps reorder things. And when you start to tell your truth, what will happen is suddenly there's a peace and a stillness that shows up inside of you that is just beyond words. And even though your world looks like there's a tornado happening because you told your truth, inside of you there's this magnificent stillness. And it's indescribable, except it feels like a golden Buddha. You've become the golden Buddha. You're like, I get it. I have to tell my truth. Non-attachment. I can't attach to what people think. I can't attach myself to a brand. I can't attach myself to making other people happy. I can't attach myself to people trying to attack me. People are allowed to think what they want and do what they want. I have to be true to me. I have to honor me. I have to come from love and light. I have to honor me. I have to teach my children how to love themselves and to honor themselves. That's what I have to do, right? What happens is the outer world starts to look crazy, but you have peace. And then in time, because it's a time-space reality, a new homeostasis takes place. And that is tough to get to. And I just wish there was a way that people who have made this decision to end their life, I just wish there was a moment that they would know that, you know, because studies prove that when people have survived suicide, for instance, I just listened to a story by a man who jumped off the Golden Gate Bridge, and he said the minute he let go of the railing, he was regretful. He wished he hadn't jumped, but he's free falling now. And he said a sea lion actually helped save his life. The sea lion kept him up until the Coast Guard could appear. Absolutely amazing. And when you listen to his story, he says, the minute I jumped, I was sorry I jumped. And so knowing that, you know, and then surviving my own suicide ideation and realizing I never wanted to die, never. I didn't want to end my life. I wanted the pain to stop. But the only way out of the pain at the moment, because all of the doors had shut and my mind just couldn't conceive a way out, and then the idea of the way out, I just didn't have enough strength to do it, you know? It was just so overwhelming. I understand it. We need compassion. And so I pray in my heart, and I believe deeply, that anyone watching this video doesn't judge people who have committed suicide, that your heart is open and you understand that a mother or a father who decides to take their life is in an incredibly dark emotional place. You know, we have the potential to go very, very dark emotionally. We all do. Where there is light, You know, there has been darkness, you know, and only true illumination can really save somebody who is that deep in desperation. But I believe that if we as a society commit ourselves to enlightenment and telling our truth, that eventually enough momentum will take place where people just know that they're supposed to honor how they feel. And people are no longer taking responsibility for other people's feelings. That doesn't mean we're not compassionate. We are compassionate, but we are super responsible for our intention and what we're putting out into the world. We understand that it's not our job to be self-righteous. It's not our job to be condemning. It's our job to send people love and light. It's our job to take care of the self and then to see others, not as victims, right, but as powerful human beings. I know that every person that I coach is a powerful human being, right? I don't believe in enabling. I believe in inspiring. I believe in me seeing in you your potential, your true potential, your God self, right? We're all extensions of infinite intelligence. We all have the light within us, right? And depending on our level of willingness and humility, that will definitely affect how deep we can go and how great we can change. So from my heart to your heart, you know, thank you for being a part of this channel. If I would love it if you would subscribe and you click the notifications button, you'll get notified of new videos. I do my best to share what I'm learning as I'm learning on the road to recovery and enlightenment. And I believe that it's about solutions. And I believe that you can change the world when you change yourself. I believe in the ripple effect. I believe that you are changing the world when you decide to tell your truth and you teach your children to tell your truth. And when you hear the people at work complaining about Kate Spade and Anthony Bourdain and all the other celebrities that are having a hard time, maybe you can share with them, you know, some of these ideas, not from a self-righteous place, but maybe you can lift the conversation up or at least don't participate in it, right? Don't participate in it. Dear ones, you are enough. Your feelings matter. And when you begin to tell your truth, what you need are life skills. You need to know how to organize your thoughts so that you can hold on to yourself, because the people who are around you who are below the veil are going to start spinning out of control because you're not taking care of them. You're not taking the bait. You're not reacting to their anger, to their bait. You know, they're trying to bait you into arguments. They're trying to condemn you. You know, they're ridiculing you. They're judging you and they're blaming you. You need life skills to be able to hold on to yourself in peace and love. Thank you for being here. I bow to the love and the light that is absolutely in you. Namaste.